HeroinChurch made a video, kind of, well, with my name at the end of it, because I think it was something to do with a comment exchange that we'd had about romantic love. And forgive the this, it may become incredibly irritating, in which case, look the other way. I just think that there is a relevance, a metaphor involved in this kind of thing. I'm not sure how well I'll be able to respond, but I think there are various factors that I can raise here which may add to the whole thing. There's a kind of series of events in any relationship or potential relationship which will or will not make it stand the test of time. And one thing which is absolutely fundamental and vital is an underlying compatibility, if you like, or a similarity. Now, some relationships work extremely well where people are very different, but unless you have a level of communication or a level of satisfaction within that relationship which works for both people, even if they are quite different, it will fail. I mean, you talked about openness and honesty and I implying really authenticity, and again, I think that's absolutely vital. You can't have a successful relationship without that, which is why so many relationships often founder as well. But I'm sort of catapulting all over the place because the I've just rewatched the video and it's kind of fresh in my mind, and there's these various elements I want to bring up. I mean, first off, you've got the attraction, the initial either physical attraction or the attraction of the person. And physical attractions aren't always, well, then, I don't know, but a lot of physical attractions aren't based pure, a lot of attractions, I should say, aren't based purely on physical attraction. There's an element of it, obviously. But it's about more than that. It's about the way the person feels about themselves, their characteristics, their confidence or lack thereof, the non-verbal communication, how they present themselves, all these different elements. And some of it is absolutely intangible and almost impossible to put your finger on. And then, of course, there has got to be a mutuality. Now, you raise something quite important in your video that, with one person, it was one way about, you found them more attractive and tried to sort of pull them in, and that it could be the other way around. And there's very often a disparity between the two. There is often one person who loves or is more attracted to the other. It is quite rare, I think, that that is exactly mutual. I think it does happen, but not frequently. And so you've kind of got that inequality to start off with. That one person is looking to the other much more. Now, sometimes that can work. The person is it better to be the person that loves more or the person who is loved more? Very hard to say. I think it depends on your character, really. I have had it both ways round, and I think realistically, there is a greater sense of fulfillment when you love more, even if there is more pain. But I mean, as I said, that's a question of personal preference. You say that it's a kind of sort of cure for life almost, and I know where you're coming from, and I think there is a space, a gap, a sense of something missing when there isn't a significant other, or there can be. The older I get, the less I feel that actually, and so That doesn't mean I don't want that, but it does mean that I can look at it perhaps from a little bit further away. But also that nobody can fill a gap in you. They can add to your life, they can enhance your life. But if we end up expecting somebody else to plug that gap, the place where we are lacking, then it will, again, it will founder and fall, because that immediately gives that person power over you. They pull the string and you off you go, because you need them, or you feel a need of them. And again, some people like to be needed, feel it's vital for them to be needed, and so that can again, work quite well if it matches. The honeymoon period of any relationship is heady and addictive for both sides, and extraordinary. You're filled with endorphins during that period. You feel like you could walk on water. And but that, whilst it's a wonderful thing in itself, is not what long-term relationships are made of. And it's that interim period where, and this actually happens with friends as well, or a lot of friends, that you go through that phase where they can do no wrong. Whatever they do is fabulous, and yeah, they're just, they're God, and possibly so are you. And then real life hits, and you have some sort of conflict or falling out. I mean, we all tend as well, I think, to present ourselves our better sides when we are first with somebody. And of course, that you can't do that indefinitely anyway. I don't think that's dishonest, but I think it's just a natural part of the process. But when you come to blows, when you come to a place where reality bites, and you see that person more for who they actually are than you did previously, it's whether you can get through, whether they still are attractive to you, and B, whether you have a vested interest in pursuing it through that. A lot of people are really frightened of conflict and of coming to blows one way or another, or of difficult explorations and negotiations. I mean, again, I'm not in the slightest bit frightened of that. I welcome that, because I'm a realist, and I welcome honesty, even if I don't like it, because I always need to know what I'm working with. That is an extremely rare thing to find in somebody else. And again, there we have the whole compatibility thing. That part of it is, what fundamentally are you needing? And what is the other person needing? And do they match? For me, there are some quite essential things, and I'm not going to launch into them here. I've raised kind of things about this in the past. And I perhaps I'll put a link to one of them that I can think of right now, but it's not really about this moving into the next bit. But for me, if you can't be truly open and truly honest, and deal with the realities of things, then a relationship for me won't make it through to the next bit. So there can often be this kind of mess in the middle, which is a testing of that relationship to see if it does and can stand the test of time. And if it can't, as you have discovered in various ways, it drifts, and you no longer want that person. That powerful, intoxicating feeling goes away, or the scales fall from your eyes, and you realise the reality of that other person, and that perhaps they don't quite match you, and it's not going to work. But beyond that, if you can get beyond that phase, that difficulty, that's actually when a relationship potentially stands the chance of lasting. It moves into a much deeper and more connected phase, and you will be much more reluctant to walk away, in fact, much less able to walk away. because you kind of, you don't become one thing, but there is this sort of entanglement of understandings and needs and journey and so on. But it's not just about looks. You know, I know it looks, it can look like that. And I think we're actually led to believe, you know, you will get a good relationship if you happen to conform to this certain set of criteria and whatever the, you know, there's a huge list that I won't go into. You're smart enough to know what most of them are. But it's actually rubbish. It's not true. For example, more attractive people. Physically attractive people, as you, I mean, as you point out, that goes anyway, but tend to often find it harder because people will look at their physicality first and be attracted to that, and often find it very hard to get past that. So sometimes it can actually be a stumbling block rather than a benefit. You know, you might have a trail of men or women or whatever is your preference behind you longing to be with you, but they will never quite make the grade because they won't perceive themselves as doing. And also, if you are somewhat unusual, as both you and I are in quite different ways, that makes it difficult as well, because you know, you need a match, you need somebody who can make sense of you. And who you can talk to, because you know, ultimately, whatever the romantic notions that we might have, or the people that we find physically attractive, or that we fall head over heels with, or become infatuated by, if we are not underneath all that friends with those people, it's not going to last either. And you know, a lot of people do get very caught up in this the high of that initial phase of a relationship, and will again, as you kind of implied, become addicted to that repeating cycle. And it's not that the other person that they're addicted to, it's not even relationship that they're addicted to, it's that high, that drug-like feeling that you can get, or you do get often in the early stages of a relationship. But just the fact that that's there doesn't mean it can be long lasting. I don't think it necessarily even needs to be there for a relationship to become a good one. I'm not sure about that. But ultimately, again, we're talking about adaptation. Sorry, I'm rambling on, but there were quite a lot of things, and I may not be being that articulate either. Either expecting the environment to adapt to you or adapting to your environment, I think there is a kind of place somewhere in the middle of that where, you know, we all have to adapt to a degree. It's no good if we are just, we see ourselves as the actual pivotal point of the entire universe and everybody has to jump and dance to our tune, because they simply won't. But there's also a huge danger in trying to fit in with everything and not adapting. And there is a happy medium there, which is quite hard to find, especially in relationship, I think, because of these things I've mentioned previously, you know, that one person will tend to be the one that adapts and the other will be the adapted too. But, and also, you know, what your criteria is, how important certain elements are for you, and where you're prepared to compromise. I still have, but she's now a long way away, a very good friend who I actually trained, who was in, and still is in, a lovely relationship, but it was never the sort of thing we're talking about here. Never didn't begin with that at all. And she questioned and doubted that relationship for a very long time because it didn't have that kind of high. But there, you know, she's been with him for years and it's an excessively happy relationship where the two people involved are free to move about, free to be themselves. So it's a complex one. It is a complex one, not one I think that anybody can provide a formula for. It's something you need to work out for yourself. But perhaps the most important thing is to decide whether it's something, it's a ride you're prepared to take on a repeated basis in order to find what you're looking for, or whether it's a repeated ride that you want to take because it's the ride itself which is the pleasure and the need met.